Our last speaker for today, according to our changed order, is Bruce Robertson of Mount Allison University, who will be speaking on the subject of working in digital humanities and classics at the small undergraduate university. Just by the way, after that, I'll have a response and then we'll have some general discussion.
Thanks, Sam. So coming as I am after a bunch of Masters of the Dog and Pony show, I sort of was anxious as to what I should do. Could I double down? But I don't have 40 virtual reality goggles for all of you or anything like that. So I thought I'd, you know, go unplugged, use the DH equivalent of acoustic guitar, which would be plain text and no slides. So I'm going to see if I can actually turn this off for us.
Yeah, really. Sure.
And I think it's appropriate for the forum because I'm really going to be talking sort of about my experience. And indeed, those experiences began around 2000 and in one of the small but impassioned digital classics conferences that began popping up around that time, a grand old man of the field elbowed me and asked quietly, "What do you notice about all the people around here, Bruce?" And it wasn't Greg. And today I might have been attuned to different disproportionalities, but for the purpose of this panel, it's fortunate that I read his mind with my first try, and I said they're almost all from undergraduate universities. And it was true. Compared to the APA or the CAC or other even smaller gatherings, this one was held at and keynoted and attended mainly by faculty at undergraduate universities. I should explain what I mean by undergraduate university here. In my book, such an institution's student population is probably about 5,000 or under, and it lacks both the responsibility and opportunities of a graduate program. These include places often called colleges in the country south of Lake Ontario, but I'm going to adhere to my native Canadian dialect during this SC conference, despite the fact that these universities are far less common in Canada than in the United States. Indeed, a recent Washington Post article surprisingly claimed that 40% of US colleges enroll fewer than 1,000 students. And of course, a good number of these are liberal arts institutions with classics front and center. Only five Canadian universities are that small, and none of them have a classics department to speak of. So there are interesting differences here. And so one explanation for the prominence of undergraduate university professors at that event 16 years ago is simply that quite a number of jobs in our field are found in such places. Anyway, the position of faculty from such places is a distinct one and deserves some consideration by this panel's audience. Whether you're on the job market, because you might end up at such a place, whether you're making your career at an undergraduate university, or you are from a larger institution and hope to understand the needs and capabilities of colleagues and collaborators who work at such places. My perspective is as one who started with a short stint just down the road from here at the Canadian U of T, not the Iranian one or the American one, in 1999, and from there I took my young family to Mount Allison University in the small town of Sackville near the border of New Brunswick and Nova Scotia, joining a three-person classics department. I've been there ever since, head of the department for the past 10 years, a perennial member of Senate, member of the Board of Regents for the past 3 years. I ought to understand how those sorts of places work. Meanwhile, I've increasingly devoted my research activity to digital classics. Roughly from 2001 to 2009, I explored the challenges of historical markup and visualization in many languages and calendrical systems. And since a digging into data partnership with Greg and others highlighted the need for something quite different, I have for the last 7 years or so worked on the optical character recognition of polytonic Greek, developing one OCR system, modifying another, and most recently devising a web interface for easily editing OCR output, with an eye to generating more training data from the edited results. And if you're interested in that, just Google Greek lace. Avoid the sites that seem to be on other topics. And the first one that looks like it's about Greek language, you've got mine. To begin, I want to point out the disadvantages of working at an undergraduate university that digital classics nicely mitigates. Consider library resources. Such a university is unlikely to build a collection similar in size to the ones that we haunted during our graduate studies. Now, while some digital projects might require extensive physical library, and most will require some time in a library, a decent part of a digital project's research can be undertaken wherever fine internet is served. Learning APIs, figuring out a new markup language, getting one digital tool to talk to another, all of these are skills whose learning resources are available online. Equally, undergraduate universities tend to pride themselves on offering greater attention to their students. And if this is to be anything but empty rhetoric, it requires a greater portion of faculty time spent during term time on those things. As I'll show, I think some digital projects can fit this very nicely. There are other more perilous aspects of the undergraduate university experience, which you can, with experience and persistence, mitigate or even turn to your advantage. For instance, you are likely to be the only digital classicist, or at least not part of a larger DH university consortium of the sort that we've just been discussing, comprising computer science experts, DH staff. This means that unless you can find a tenure stream member of an equally small computing science faculty, which takes an interest in your issues, an unlikely prospect, you are on your own when it comes to managing computer hardware and software. You may be able to hire undergraduates through various grants, but this is a staff in which you should never trust your critical assets or to whom you should never delegate the task of setting strategy. Therefore, learn to price out, buy, and replace that hard drive yourself. Should you go with Django or Flask for the web publishing microframework, it's your call and nobody else's, because you'll have to live with it well beyond the life cycle of an undergraduate worker. Instead, delegate smaller tasks to your undergraduate teammates and delegate the tactical decisions that pertain thereto. Assume that they will take an enormous amount of time to get started. Never complain about this, and always prove to yourself beforehand that nothing you delegate is a death march. I have come to love this lone wolf, or perhaps more accurately, small pack existence. In particular, when I visit large universities, I'm always amazed at everyone else's tolerance for meeting after meeting and the need to navigate office politics around the completion of an academic project. When I go home, I call the shots. It's my code that fails or succeeds. Of course, for it to succeed in a timely fashion, I have to become a jack of all trades computationally. It's not just me, it's my experience that the undergraduate digital classicists know quite a bit about bash shell shortcuts, command line XML verification, RDF query engines, Docker versus Vagrant, and many more nitty-gritty computer issues. I notice these faculty often share a beer with their programming staff of the programming staff of large-scale projects because they have the same interests and problems. Small universities tend to have fewer policies and more decisions made ad hoc and therefore based on trust and competency. Here also, the digital classicist at an undergraduate university will find general technical competency to be greatly helpful. Should the institution's virtual server be available for your digital project? Should it join a digital library consortium for your project's benefit? Should it serve external domain names for machines inside its network? Et cetera, et cetera. I found myself pleasantly on the right side of these decisions because I think it has been possible to establish relations of trust based on successful past performance. My IT department allows me to run my own servers under my own domain names using whatever operating system I please. Of course, they won't support these servers, and they'll lower the boom if I screw up. I think that's fair. A smaller university should understand that what it can't achieve through bigger budgets, it can hope to achieve through permissiveness based in trust. If your IT department doesn't get this, your deans and provosts will. I've portrayed the work of a digital classicist at an undergraduate university as pleasingly autonomous, but I should note there's a very serious potential pitfall in this condition. Ultimately, our work is part of a larger ecology of tools, ideas, and problems, the shape of which those of us at undergraduate universities have far less power to influence than do colleagues at larger institutions. Since there is neither the opportunity nor the obligation to conform internally to your institution, we need to avoid the delusion created by this situation, namely that we don't need to conform to anything anywhere. This is true when it comes to frameworks as much as to the purpose of a project. For every Project Bamboo, an ultimately unsuccessful attempt at a cyber infrastructure initiative for the arts and humanities, conceived through a consortium of large D8 shops across the US, I venture to guess there were at the same time dozens of solo projects that fizzled out because the researchers figured the first thing needed was to reinvent PHP, or the Unicode character encoding in its standard, or the text encoding initiative's text markup. We're all subject to the not invented here syndrome, wanting to improve on standards that don't exactly fit our needs. But large shops have some investment in those larger standards, either through the competencies of their staff or through actual participation in their formulation. So they're inclined to support them. In contrast, when you're at an institution of 2,000 students, it will always be the case that nothing was ever invented here. And it's tempting to conclude that there is an urgent need to clear ground by doing fundamental work of this sort. This is perilous for two reasons. First, in isolation, we are poorer equipped to assess the need for rewriting a standard in this way. Second, we have far less opportunity to proselytize for our work than those would at a larger center. I have a personal example of this. In 2001, I received a federal government grant to work on historical event markup and linking, an XML schema and related visualization tools for history writ large. It aimed to provide support for multiple calendrical schemes and multiple languages, and generated cool animated maps and timelines. Eventually, I ported this to an RDF backend. Today, 15 years later, it is unused. True, the schema informs some related ideas in TEIP 5, and I like to think that the presentations and articles influenced other people's ideas of how to visualize the past. For all the times that I was called in as a hired gun to glue this into a historical project, work that was very satisfying and produced lasting friendships, I don't think one external project ever adopted this markup scheme. It was a solution looking for a problem that never quite came along. Greg Crane and his Perseus developer at this time, David Mimno, staged something of an intervention for me at one point, trying to get me to change course so that this project would effectively respond to the projects of projects like, you know, Perseus. But at that time, I was too invested in certain fundamental positions that I wouldn't respond. I believe it was my week-to-week isolation that made me unable to discern productive directions for this. If I had been working at Tufts or UVA, I would have had intellectually conformed to these needs. Certainly at such places, I would have had more of an opportunity to sell the project, for better or for worse. One factor here is the seasonal nature of research at an undergraduate university. If there's any truth in my institution's hype about one-to-one time, well then we gotta spend some time with these students. Moreover, being a department of three and a third people that offers ancient languages, we in classics at Mount Allison do quite a bit of so-called overload teaching and upper year reading. Ideally then, a project should not require year-round tending to, either because the project itself has a sort of periodic quality to it, or because collaborators can pick up during the slack busy time. Moreover, while universities with graduate students can find workers to keep the project apace during term time, my only source of labor is undergrads, most of whom rightly recognize that it is in their best interest to devote themselves to studies from September to April. Over time, as Chris shows, it's possible to develop an undergraduate club in which research-related work gets done, but try foisting that on graduate students. But not any old project will fit the competencies of undergraduates or their interests. So far, I've argued that the relatively solitary quality of digital work in an undergraduate university demands that its practitioner have a wide understanding of her medium, and that this, plus the self-determined nature of the work environment, can make her very productive. However, inasmuch as digital work is for others, either to clarify our common information and organize it, she is at a disadvantage by not being locally connected to other scholars. The solution is for her to conceive of her project and continue it in constant collaboration with others externally. In any case, my most successful current projects are of this nature. Far from being a solution in search of a problem, our current work was conceived around a workshop table where the need for effective Greek OCR became painfully clear to all of us. And I've pursued this work as part of an assembly line or as a service, ensuring that it is fulfilling someone else's imminent need. Without a doubt, the most fulfilling period of this work has been the last 6 months or so, as I've been part of the team publishing an open first 1,000 years of Greek. A number of partners of this are in the room right now. I promise you I wrote this without knowing that was going to happen. But try not to get a tear in my eye. It's the teamwork that makes a difference. In contrast to the historical work, I'm not trying to convince anyone of why I'm doing what I'm doing. I just need to do it. Of course, it helps that the team comprises enthusiastic, mutually supportive people. Being part of a team means that you need to allow other phases of the work to take place at other institutions. In this case, I have a web interface for publishing raw Greek OCR data and for collaboratively editing these results. But the final stage goes to Leipzig, and Matthew Munson is designing a web interface for that. In the manner of a big DH group at a large university, I'm part of a cast and crew, just one that happens to be external to the university. It's not like one of those short movies whose credits read, script by Kanye West, directed by Kanye West, music by Kanye West, you know. Two further factors make this collaboration pleasing and successful. First, we hold regular weekly meetings on Hangout. I think everybody thinks that's for them, but it's actually for me, because it constantly reorients me in the course of a busy term toward my research, and it reorients the research side of me to the practical concerns of people who are using my data. Second, we measure our progress. If, as a group, we aim to finish 4 million words edited, and I have shipped 3 million, I'm 75% done. Obviously, it's not that simple. Quality matters too, but knowing where you are in a project helps drive you through it. Finally, optical character recognition is truly a field in which the efforts of an intensive season of research, in my case, the non-teaching spring and summer terms, can contribute to general useful results through busier times without a great deal of additional effort. This is because once classifiers have been trained for various fonts and page layouts, once pre-processing pipelines have been designed and tested, and once an editing environment has been coded, there's not a lot more to do but just issue a magic command on the high-performance computing grid and wait a couple of days for the toaster to pop. Additionally, I find coding something that is pleasing and satisfying to do at home in the evenings after a day of teaching when everyone's in bed. I do not feel the same way about writing. So I encourage digitally oriented faculty at larger centers continually to seek out faculty at smaller universities. As I've argued, they may well have complementary skill sets and a generalist attitude. They're likely to be grateful for the 30,000-foot view of the field that a larger operation can provide, and Tufts in particular has played that role in my life so amply. Before I conclude, I want to address two more topics of practical importance to faculty at the undergraduate university. One is the issue of research funding, and the last is how this work might affect your progress through the ranks. The undergraduate university has fewer resources to support grant writing than their larger counterparts. The situation is constantly improving, but it remains the case. Furthermore, a somewhat greater teaching load means that the individual scholar has probably less time to devote to this. At the same time, pressure to apply for grants is ever increasing, at least in the Canadian context. Finally, once a professor at an undergraduate university gets a grant, he will likely spend a large portion of it bringing undergraduate students up to speed. Thus, the cost-benefit ratio for grant applications in undergraduate universities is different than in larger ones, and sometimes it does make sense just to power through on a project without seeking funds. But the professor in this sort of university should not therefore convince himself that national grant competitions are never for him. I'd say that in today's academy, if you're 50 or under, you're expected to take a turn at the plate. Once again, the essentially collaborative nature of digital work is an excellent means of mitigating these problems. Become part of a group of people who help each other write grant applications, taking turns to be the PEI. In one such circle, I'm a resident expert in English. I gotta say, this is a great gig because you just fix other people's prose and they love you for it. 3 years ago, in the circle around Greg, I took a turn captaining an application that was shortlisted for a grant administered through Hattie Trust. We didn't get the money, but I learned a great deal and could articulate what I was doing much better. Digital projects have the advantage that various innovation funds are available alongside the discipline-specific ones, and if you take turns at the plate in the big leagues of large national or international grants, you'll probably have enough skills, not to mention leftover prose, to put together a really great application on the smaller funds. Progress to the ranks, my last point. You have a great obligation to yourself, your loved ones, and the department that hired you to successfully progress to the ranks of your institution. Since what constitutes a winning application is largely locally configured social construct, I can't tell you exactly what that means to you. 1 week before I interviewed at Mount Allison, I also interviewed at a fine, large U.S. university. There I was told, in no uncertain terms by the chair of the search, that I would, if I got the job, drop all this digital dallying immediately. 6 months later, in my undergraduate university, I was being introduced by my dean of arts to a faculty assembly as someone who does very exciting things with computation. These cues matter. Nevertheless, and to return to the question that started this paper, there are structural reasons for digital projects being more pertinent at a small undergraduate university and possibly being more helpful in progress through the ranks. It's my observation that opposition to digital humanities tend to come most from within departments and divisions by those who see it as an abrogation of traditional skills and responsibilities. Large graduate departments, likely more productive in their scholarship, for that very reason have become more likely to be invested in traditional modes of inquiry. Small departments, in contrast, are less invested with respect to research. Additionally, its members are more likely to be evaluated by those from outside the discipline or even the humanities in general. In my case, the tenure and promotion committee comprises faculties from all disciplines, and it could be chaired by a dean of science. A particularly enthusiastic computer scientist held forth at my tenure hearing over a decade ago on the true interdisciplinarity of my work. It was fun to just sit back and listen. To wrap up, I hope I've given neither the impression that, in my opinion, the undergraduate university is somehow a better environment for digital work, nor worse. Certainly, in one way or another, digital research methods and the development of digital research materials will continue to be part of our discipline. I truly believe that if we develop these projects that entail collaboration across universities of different sizes and emphasis, the result will be better outcomes for the project and a more robust field in general. Thank you very much. While you're thinking about your questions, I'm going to put in here a happy last note, and that is that you can also use digital studies to get tenure stream positions in a really, really tough environment. I've just got word from my provost that, barring the president's signature, we will be announcing a position that has a small digital component, replacing a retiring scholar of Greek and Latin literature, which in a department of three people is sort of life or death. So it's very good news. And if you have people out there who would fit that bill, let them know that that announcement is coming. Yeah, that laugh line didn't go anywhere, so clearly I'm misreading the room, yeah. Yeah.
It's a bit superficial, but like, I wonder how important is physical travel when you have a small institution, and in particular, does the institution like support undergraduate travel to conferences, getting your students out there and meeting the community face-to-face?
I found there's more like slush money at my. I think it probably depends on the nature of the small place more than like small big. And in that regard, I find at my place it's easier to get hands on money for something like that. Again, on a kind of basis of trust. So if there's a student who's doing something good, I can shovel them money. I don't know if others can, but I can as head, and there will only be two or three or four, so it's really not that big a deal. So I do have a fledgling digital club, which is also on Friday afternoons, and pizza sometimes is involved, and that runs like longer than I can take it, from 4:30 to 7 or something like that. Then in the summer, those who work with me work full time. Yeah, So if I have the funds, then I'll have students work with me full time. And then sometimes I'll give people piecework.
Can they do volunteer activity through their own semesters?
That would be the club.
Okay.
Yeah, and that I didn't mention this project, but that's a transcription of the text on lead tags from Siskia at the University of Zagreb. This is really somebody else's project, and I'm just really providing the undergraduate labor, but it's, so it's Marianne Lame at Pisa is the kind of captain of that, and she comes on, we have a 60-inch screen, and she comes on as Big Mother, and she tends to do this, and we know it's like 10 o'clock at night on a Friday night for her. It's very intimidating to our students, you know, and she, is everybody having any troubles? You know, she'll sort of whisper into the crowd.
Haven't you also been collaborating with Boschetti at Pisa, is that right?
Yeah, that's true. Federico Boschetti and I work on the OCR together, and he has a pretty broad understanding of the computational matters involved, so he's kind of kept me sane as well, yeah.